A very good evening and welcome to Rehabilitation Science Group YouTube channel. Today we will be presenting a lecture on deep gluteal syndrome by Dr. Esther Lianage. Dr. Esther is a PhD in sports and exercise science. She is also an NPT in musculoskeletal and sports physiotherapy. She is presently working as a lecturer at the Department of Physiotherapy, Faculty of Allied Health Sciences, University of Peradeniya in Sri Lanka. She has been a supervisor for undergraduate research programs. She has been a reviewer of articles and conferences. She is also a renowned national and international speaker at various physiotherapy and allied health conferences. She has worked as a national physiotherapist with the women's cricket team of Sri Lanka. She has many publications to her credit. We welcome Dr. Esther today for her lecture on deep gluteal syndrome. Welcome, Dr. Esther, and you may proceed now. We would like to take your consent for presentation to be made live on YouTube before you start.
Yes, you may make it.
मेरा तो
मन था कि जाके बिरयानी वरानी ले
Dr. Harpreet introduced me. I am Esther Lianage, a physiotherapist and a lecturer in Sri Lanka. And today I will be talking about the topic deep gluteal syndrome. Now, I don't know how much most of us or all of us are familiar with this term, but this is an entity which is not looked much into. So I think it is a good topic to be learned or listened to. So we will move into the topic. Now, by definition, deep gluteal syndrome is an underdiagnosed entity and it is characterized by pain, dysesthesias in the buttock area, hip or posterior thigh. Also, it presents with radicular pain due to non-discogenic sciatic nerve entrapment in the subgluteal space. So we can understand from this definition that this syndrome involves the entrapment of the sciatic nerve, but it is not discogenic. It is in the subgluteal space. Another thing which we often come across is that whenever we come across a patient who presents with sciatic nerve involvement in the gluteal region, they are quickly ruled out or kind of diagnosed as piriformis syndrome and treated as piriformis syndrome. But what we need to understand is that when there is sciatic nerve involvement in the gluteal region, it is not only the piriformis muscle, but it could be the entrapment due to any other structures also. So these structures could range from fibrous bands containing blood vessels, gluteal muscles, hamstring muscles, gemelli obturator internus complex, vascular abnormalities, and space occupying lesions. So, I don't know if it is familiar already, but now the term deep gluteal syndrome is more preferred over piriformis syndrome. Now, this deep gluteal syndrome is an umbrella term that includes piriformis syndrome, gemelli obturator internus syndrome. We all know that gemelli and obturator internus, the obturator internal muscle is also a hip muscle. So entrapment of the sciatic nerve in the deep pelvic obturator internal muscle is known as gemelli obturator internus syndrome. And it could be ischiofemoral impingement syndrome and also proximal hamstring syndrome. So deep gluteal syndrome is an umbrella term for all these conditions. Now, when we talk about the anatomy of the deep gluteal space, we can look at this picture where we can see, of course, these are the structures. And then, of course, I cannot show the posterior borders over here, but posteriorly, the deep gluteal space, posteriorly, the border is gluteus maximus. Anteriorly, it is the posterior acetabular column, hip joint capsule, and proximal femur. Laterally, it is the lateral lip of the lineae aspera. Medially, it is the sacrotuberous ligament. Superiorly, it is the inferior margin of the sciatic notch, and inferiorly, it is the origin of the hamstrings at ischial tuberosity over here. So from here, we can understand that the anatomy of the deep gluteal space over here is unique because the sciatic nerve, as you can see this yellow structure, is entering the pelvis through the sciatic notch, and then it follows its course downwards down the thigh. So the anatomy is such that the course of the sciatic nerve is influenced greatly by the mobility of the hip movements. Okay. So what I'm trying to say briefly is the anatomy shows us that the sciatic nerve is entering the pelvis through the sciatic notch. Thereafter, as it follows its course, it is greatly influenced by the movements in the hip joint. Okay. The common causes for developing deep gluteal pain syndrome are being in sitting posture for too long, repetitive activities like running, walking, climbing stairs, and this can also imply for people involved in sports where they do not have enough conditioning before they perform these activities, or it could be due to contact sports where there is a direct injury to any of the structures in the deep gluteal space, or it could be an accident or fall or any twisting movement at the hip that was too quick. Now, when we talk about diagnosing deep gluteal syndrome, we need to understand that the diagnosis of deep gluteal syndrome is based on comprehensive history and physical examination of the hip. And I'm sure as physiotherapists and people involved in exercise and sports, we all are aware that hip pain cannot be isolated just to the hip, and it needs to be, before even diagnosing something as isolated to the hip, we need to know that we need to rule out involvement of the spine. And we know that lumbar spine movements also play a very important role in hip pain. Therefore, a differentiation of problems coming from the spine should be performed during history and physical examination. And once, after proper history taking and physical examination, the lumbar pathology is ruled out by specific tests and by spinal imaging, then we can perform physical examination, which can be directed towards deep gluteal space as a cause of posterior hip pain. Okay, so what I'm trying to say is we need to rule out lumbar pathology. And what patients present with, now when we talk about history taking, we of course take a comprehensive history, isn't it, of how they got it and how long it has been and all that. So patients with sciatic nerve entrapment often have a previous history of trauma or symptoms of sit pain, especially sit pain. And then they complain of radicular pain of the lower back or the hip and paresthesias of the affected leg. The patient may present with neurological symptoms also, like abnormal reflexes and motor weaknesses. Sometimes the symptoms of the patient might be similar to hamstring tear or any kind of intra-articular hip pathology. So they will present with aching, burning sensation, cramping in the hip region and the posterior thigh. One thing that can help us in differentiating the condition based on the symptoms of the patient is we can try to assess in which position the pain increases or with which activity the pain increases. For example, as it is written here, if the patient complains that prominently their pain is either persistent or it is aggravated by sitting or being seated for too long, this indicates that the sciatic nerve entrapment may be beneath the piriformis muscle. Whereas if the patient complains that they feel severe pain in walking, right? If they say that their pain is prominently during walking, and the pain when you palpate is the tenderness is lateral to the ischium, then you can expect that this may be associated with ischiofemoral impingement. So what is ischiofemoral impingement? In ischiofemoral impingement, the lesser trochanter rubs the lateral border of the ischium. Here, as we see, the lateral border of the ischium and the lesser trochanter. Now, this impingement could be because of any abnormalities in the anatomical and functional reasons. But if this reduction in space is in between the ischium and the lesser trochanter is because of any soft tissue structure, it is often because of the quadratus femoris muscle. And as we can well see that when the space is reduced, the sciatic nerve gets impinged in between the two structures. As a result, the patient experiences more pain while walking. Okay. Now, when we move on to the signs and symptoms of deep gluteal pain syndrome, there are several typical factors which can be helpful in assessing deep gluteal pain syndrome. So like said before, it is repeating again in most rare areas that the patients with deep gluteal syndrome will present with pain over the lower back gluteal area, and often the involving pain runs down the back of the thigh. And of course, we all know when there is a nerve involvement, the nature of pain is different. So because the sciatic nerve is involved here, the patient may feel pins and needles or tingling or numbness anywhere down the leg, which could run into the shin or even to the foot. And then again, they complain of pain after sitting for a long period of time. Also, it could be that when they are seated for a long period of time and as they attempt to get up, also the pain is more. Why this happens is because of our body weight being constantly or being on the inflamed and irritated structures for a long time, which will aggravate the symptoms in the gluteal region. Also, some patients might complain of symptoms getting worse after long periods of activity. Why this happens is because we know if there is involvement of tendons or muscles, as we just said, what happens is they are already inflamed or they are already irritated. And prolonged activities like walking, climbing stairs, running, jogging, what happens is these structures are led to overuse and they are actually hypersensitive tissues. So they will lead to worsening of the symptoms. Okay. Now, the commonly reported symptoms, like said, is the hip or pain in the buttock pain and tenderness in the gluteal region. One thing to be noted is that it is not often bilateral. Deep gluteal syndrome is often unilateral, that is often on one side. Yeah, and it is unilateral. And then the pain is aggravated in the attempt to rotate the hip. In the attempt to rotate the hip in flexion with knee in extension. Also, the other symptom could be intolerance for sitting more than 20 to 30 minutes, patient presence with limping and disturbed or loss of sensation in the affected extremity, and also some complain of pain at night, but that pain is gone during the day. So these are the typical symptoms which any patient with deep gluteal syndrome may present with. Now, what we need to understand is that all these symptoms are a mix and could be seen in, you remember, we had the umbrella term where the cause for deep gluteal syndrome could be involvement of different structures or different sort of impingement. Now, these symptoms definitely would vary according to the cause which has led to deep gluteal pain syndrome. Now, when we talk about assessing patients with whoever, now, of course, we don't know if it is deep gluteal pain syndrome now when a patient comes to us. Now, how do we assess them? Now, in all kinds of sciatic pain, as said before, I want to repeat it, that spinal pathology should be ruled out first with proper history and radiographic examinations, okay? Thereafter, we can always move into our physical examination where we can perform specific tests which will be helpful in evaluating patients with posterior hip pain, okay? So there are these two tests which I would like to talk of. First is by name, it is the seated piriformis stretch test and the active piriformis test. The seated piriformis stretch test is a passive test which is performed by the therapist while they palpate the deep gluteal region. What they do is they take the patient's hip into flexion, adduction, and internal rotation. And when we talk about the active piriformis test, as the name suggests, the patient has to do it by themselves. And the patient is asked to move their hip into active abduction and external rotation while the examiner monitors the piriformis. Now, something very important about these two tests is that they are really valid and reliable tests because by research, it is shown that the combination of the seated piriformis stretch test with the piriformis active test, there is sensitivity of 91% and specificity of 80% for the endoscopic finding of sciatic nerve. So we can see that the sensitivity and specificity is very high for these two tests. Now, I will show the same tests in pictures so that it's more clearer. As you all can see here in figure A, this is the seated piriformis stretch test, in which you can see that the individual is in high sitting position while the therapist palpates the deep gluteal region. The patient's leg or the hip is taken into flexion, adduction, and internal rotation. Any aggravation in the pain is positive for the test. And as seen in figure B, the patient is in sideline position with the affected leg towards the examiner. Again, the piriformis muscle is being palpated. I hope you all are aware and know our anatomy well, that piriformis runs between the sacrum and the greater trochanter. And then the patient has the foot on the couch, and by raising the knee out, what happens is they are moving their hip joint into abduction and external rotation. Okay. So these are the tests to confirm the involvement of piriformis muscle. Now, when we talk about palpation of the deep gluteal space, you know, we all know that in our assessment, palpation is very important. Now, as we see in figure A, y'all can see this marker here, the black margin is the margin for the greater sciatic notch. And then through this, you can see the red line is the passage of the piriformis muscle. These yellow lines coming out of the greater sciatic notch is the course of the sciatic nerve, okay? And as you see in figure B, you know this is the ischium, isn't it? This is the ischium. Here, this marked red line is the lateral aspect of the ischium. And passing through this from here, you know, it is the origin. This, the dotted lines, is the path of the hamstring muscles. And again, as you see here, this is the passage, the yellow lines. This is the passage of the sciatic nerve. And when we see figure C, you know this is the ischium. And here, this, as I show the arrow, this is the medial aspect of the ischium. Here in blue is the course of, or the position of, the sacrotuberous ligament. And yellow line here shows the pudendal nerve. One thing that we can do is that while we go through the, of course, we cannot be palpating the nerves, but the structures which are actually palpable could be performed by having the ischium as the reference point. Now, I'm sure you all would remember, I had told you two tests about the piriformis. Now we will move into specific tests to rule out ischiofemoral impingement, okay? So as we see in figure A, what is shown is the therapist palpates the deep gluteal space, and the test hip is taken into extension. There is no adduction or no abduction, but just the hip is taken into extension. If the patient is positive for ischiofemoral impingement, what happens is, in doing this procedure or maneuver, the pain will be recreated, okay? And as seen in figure B, the symptomatic hip is passively taken into abduction and extension, right? So when it is moved into abduction and extension, the patient does not have any aggravation in the pain. So when you perform these two maneuvers, you can confirm if the presence of ischiofemoral impingement, or you can actually rule out the involvement of ischiofemoral impingement. Then to move on to confirm the involvement of hamstring or not, okay? What can be done is active hamstring test can be performed. As seen in figure A, we have the patient in high sitting position with the knee in 90 degrees. Look here, it's in 90, it should be 90. They've already moved it into flexion, that's why, or it should be 90 degrees of flexion. And the deep gluteal space is being palpated with the other hand. Now, with the knee in 90 degrees flexion, the therapist applies resistance to knee flexion. If the patient is positive for hamstring involvement, the therapist will feel that there is no problem with the strength. The patient has normal strength and there will be no pain. Whereas, as seen in figure B, when the same test is performed at 30 degrees of knee flexion and the therapist applies resistance to knee flexion, they will feel that there is weakness and there is recreation of symptoms. That is, at 30 degrees of knee flexion, when resistance is applied further into knee flexion, the patient will complain of increased pain at the original site. And the therapist will be able to feel that the strength is not normal. So the results of these two maneuvers as shown here for active hamstring test will help you in ruling out the presence of hamstring syndrome, which is also known as ischial tunnel syndrome. Okay. Now in brief, I tried to present it all in one table to differentiate while diagnosing. So if there is involvement, as seen here, if the involvement is pudendal nerve entrapment, then what would the history be like? Then the patient would often present with pain worsened by sitting, which does not wake the patient at night. And then when you do a physical examination, you will see that there is tenderness at the medial aspect of ischium. If there is ischiofemoral impingement, the patient will present with sciatic nerve kind of complaints, lower back pain, limping. Then when you perform your physical examination, you will find that the patient will complain of pain during terminal hip extension during long stride walking. Okay, you should know what long stride is. And during long stride walking, they will have pain in terminal hip extension. Also, the patients will have tenderness at lateral ischium and the positive ischiofemoral impingement test, which is this one. Yeah, so this impingement test will be positive in case of ischiofemoral impingement. Then if the reason for deep gluteal pain is greater trochanter ischial impingement, the patient will present with sciatic nerve complaints and limping, and there will be tenderness at posterior aspect of the greater trochanter, and there will be pain in deep flexion, abduction, and external rotation of the hip. If the reason for deep gluteal pain syndrome is ischial tunnel syndrome, then in the history, you will find that the patient will present with sciatic nerve complaints, there will be limping, and there will be increased pain while attempting flexion of the hip and extension of the knee. Physical examination will reveal tenderness at lateral ischium and positive hamstring active test, which is this one will be positive. So this is just in brief how I am trying to put across of how you can differentiate and confirm the causes for deep gluteal pain syndrome, which is not always actually piriformis. Okay. All right. So we'll move on to the treatments. So the patient could be treated with myofascial release, which will help to reduce pain and muscle tension. They can also be given stretching and strengthening exercises, which will help in reducing the symptoms and also in reducing the likelihood of re-injury in future. And another exercise that we can involve and is very important is sciatic nerve glides and hip circumduction exercises, which will help in the excursion, you know, stretching or the mobility of the sciatic nerve, and they should be performed gently. Muscle energy technique can be performed to improve strength and range of motion. Now, this last point here is something I found in research, which is still being looked into. There is no confirmed evidence about it, but something that we can kind of gain from this is there is research going on, and among all of y'all who are seeing, who are interested in research-based findings, you have this option open. And if you work in clinical settings where there is opportunity for you to get patients with deep gluteal pain syndrome, you can always try to assess the effectiveness of this technique, which is known as Grayston technique. It is being assessed for effectiveness in treating patients with deep gluteal syndrome. This is actually a form of manual therapy known as soft tissue instrument assisted mobilization. It is one of a number of manual therapy approaches that uses instruments with a specialized form of massage or scraping the skin and myofascia gently. So as I mentioned here, it's not proven yet, but it is certainly an area of research. So anyone interested could always look into it and might involved in studying it and have findings in future which would be helpful for our field. And like I said, that we will be giving strengthening exercises over here. We should remember to limit our exercises to only about 15 to 20 minutes in the beginning to ensure compliance. Also, it is best to avoid stretching at the start of the treatment in case of tendinopathy being a reason. But we can always add stretching later when the pain settles, okay? And it is always advisable to combine exercises with neural gliding. And we need to advise our patients on gluteal strengthening, progressive loading, with focus on hip extensors, abductors, and lateral rotators. I tried to put all these treatment techniques in one slide. As we can see here in the first picture, this is myofascial release done by the patient or the individual themselves. If they are in a state to do it, they could always do it on a foam roller. How they can do it is they position themselves, first of all, on the foam roller in between the sacrum and where their pain is, of course. And as they position themselves, they need to find the place where the tender point is. And as they locate the tender point, what they do is they put a downward pressure on the foam roller and hold the pressure for about 1 minute. And at the end of 1 minute, they will be able to feel that the tender point is loosened up. So they can release the pressure at this point, and they can always again realign themselves to a point where they experience or feel another tender point, and they could repeat pressurizing the tender point against the foam roller for another 1 minute until they feel it's loosened up, and then they can release it. This is doing by itself. And then soft tissue release can also be done by the therapist. Here in this figure marked as A is the hip circumduction exercise. I don't know if this red circle is very clear, but it indicates the arrows which shows that it goes from here. So if we begin from here, which is the middle, there you see the patient pulls the affected knee towards the chest. No, from here. And then they take it into abduction, lateral rotation. And then finally, they bring it into adduction. So it is to the middle, up flexion, abduction, lateral rotation, middle, and again, internal rotation. That's how it needs to go. How this helps is this helps in maintaining the mobility of the hip and also maintaining the excursion of the sciatic nerve. One thing that we need to be mindful of is that in the acute stage, when the structures are still irritated, the patient may not be able to move the hip into extreme external rotation like this over here or over here. So we will have to limit it, and we can always advise them to do a circumduction in a smaller range. And as seen over here in B, this is an example, one example. We all know there are several ways of stretching it. One example is stretching in this way, where the affected foot is crossed and placed on the contralateral knee, and the patient pulls the knee towards themselves. In doing so, the hip is taken into flexion, adduction, and internal rotation. And this figure C shows the sciatic nerve sliding exercise, in which you can see there are two maneuvers that could be done. That is, the patient in high sitting with knee in extension, the neck could be taken into flexion and the foot could be taken to plantar flexion, as you see these two red arrows at the same time. And another way is to take the neck into extension and the foot into dorsiflexion, the foot into dorsiflexion and the neck into extension at the same time. Now, according to the tolerance of the patient, this stretch can be held for 20 to 30 seconds. And also to start with, it could be repeated 3 times and progressed gradually. Now, this is the picture of muscle energy technique, which can be done. Now, we all know even muscle energy technique is reciprocal inhibition or post-isometric relaxation. Now, this is an example of post-isometric relaxation, where what we'll do is, you can see the patient is in prone lying with the knee bent, yeah? The knee is bent and the leg will have to be rotated externally to the maximum range possible for the patient, okay? At this position, what the therapist needs to do is the therapist applies a force from here. What I mean is from the medial side of the leg on both sides, the therapist will resist internal rotation. Okay, so at this point, the patient will be asked to do internal rotation against about 20% of resistance. And this resistance, and while doing so, there will be isometric contraction. And the isometric contraction will be held for 10 seconds and released. When the contraction is released, the leg, both the legs are taken further into external rotation, to a greater range of external rotation. And that greater range of external rotation has to be held for about 30 seconds. And after holding it for 30 seconds, again, the therapist can apply resistance to internal rotation, 20% of resistance. And this isometric contraction will again be held for 10 seconds and released. And after the release, again, this external rotation could be attempted to be taken into a greater range, okay? Now, this procedure can be repeated, that is isometric contraction, relaxation, isometric contraction, relaxation, and increased range of motion can be repeated to the point when the patient cannot move their leg more or further into external rotation. Now, this is a very good way to improve the range of motion as well as strength. which is not sure if we can do in acute stages as well, but later progressively this exercise could certainly be included. Right, so I am done with my presentation. This is the list of references. So what I've actually tried to do is just to give a brief outline about deep gluteal pain syndrome, which is thought to be an under-identified entity. I hope this would certainly help all of us in our place of practice, where we will not confirm every patient with hip pain as piriformis syndrome, but we will try to look into what the other reasons could be and confirm the diagnosis and treat accordingly. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Easter, for explaining deep gluteal pain in a very simple language. You explained well, and you distinguished the means. It's not the always the piriformis syndrome. It could be the various reasons could be there for the deep gluteal pain could be there. And in a very well-managed way, you defined us how to differentially diagnose between all the syndromes, and then you told about the different treatment strategies for deep gluteal syndrome. Ma'am, is there anything, just like all this MFR and the self-stretching is there, because nowadays we are finding it out, our sitting posture is for more than 8 hours are there.
Exactly.
So, is something like this, ki, how we can prevent it? Because all things are happening because of the poor posture and the ergonomics and all. So what advice you would be giving to prevent it?
Well, I think, I don't know how to say. We all know it's become a massive problem globally that all of our seated posture is now for too long, isn't it? And it's got even worse because of the work from home thing that's happening. I don't know. You know, first of all, we all need to understand, and even in the, I must admit and say that all the conferences that we attend, teaching us about being fit and all that, everywhere what is said is we need to take a break. We need to take a break. We need to get up. We need to walk. I don't know how much and how we all really practice it. It sounds very simple, but it could be of great help to all of us, and we need to understand and we need to realize and put it into practice that when there is long hours of sitting, basic ergonomics, we need to take a break, get up, stretch ourselves, move around, walk around and sit again. Yes, but also this doesn't only help. Of course, I cannot clearly say how we can kind of prevent it, how much ever you design your chairs, you still will tend to have it, but we can always work on having breaks. If we can get up and then we stretch and then we sit again, once the patient gets it, of course there are some kind of saddle seats and cushions, which might be funny if we use in our day-to-day work, but that's not something we can use. But there are seats available which would reduce pressure on our gluteal region when we are seated. But it is all for all of us to, how much ever, of course we can always try conditioning our muscles and we can try to stay fit. Apart from all that, we need to have a break from this cycle of sitting for continuous hours and take a break of stand, walk around. Now look at this. Now even in this lecture it was only half an hour, but if it is a 2 hours lecture, we go on and on. I think it has to be a lifestyle change. So that is what I want to say. And it has to be a big change,
And what do you think about the role of the body mass index?
Of course. It is obvious and we all can know and understand that if a patient is obese, eventually the whole body weight that goes through the spine is all on their gluteal region. And then they are more prone, of course. Also, there. So it will certainly increase the chances of developing it, which could also be a risk factor for developing. And people who are actually obese can always work on reducing weight.
Because we find it out in the obese persons, all the rotations are limited.
Yes.
Especially the external rotations are limited. Okay, yes. So what you would suggest means what techniques we should use? Because in the all the obese persons, MFR would be difficult because
yes,
it's,
I know.
It would be yes. There. Which so technique like, you would prefer?
So just like I mentioned to you, we can always start with maybe mobility exercises. We all know also, even to take them prone, even to try this post isometric relaxation would be very difficult with obese patients to even position them in prone lying. So with obese patients, what is often very easy is to go for mobility exercises and nerve gliding. And like you said, if the external rotator strength is weak, we certainly need to work on increasing the strength, which could be begun with, like I said, the circumduction exercises that I showed and nerve gliding. Nerve gliding is something they can really do, and strengthening exercises as well.
Is there any role of these shoe modifications?
Now, in particular for deep gluteal syndrome, it could be if it is because if the cause is anatomical or if the cause is because of malalignment of the femur, then yes, it might certainly help if there could be some shoe modifications done. And then, like I said, it could be because of repetitive activities in runners who are not conditioned well, and so that could be addressed too, and so it can be addressed by conditioning and strengthening.
Thank you, Dr. Lister, for giving all the solving all the questions. Definitely with your lecture, all the professionals and students would come to know about the deep gluteal syndrome, and they would differentiate between the different conditions, and they would find it out. It's not only the preformis syndrome for the gluteal pain. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you.